Hello and welcome to Politics Today. I'm Farooq Pitafi. Today we are going to talk about something which has hardly anything to do with politics. It might have something to do with international politics or political economy. One statement that has actually created a lot of heated debate in Pakistan is by acting assistant, U.S. Acting Assistant Secretary of State, Alice Wells. Her doubts or her comments about CPEC project and how it is going to translate into more troubles for Pakistan is quite interesting, because A, immediately there was a reaction. Miss Alice Wells is a friend of Pakistan. One question that, of course, everybody is talking about Pakistan, let us talk about the US as well. She is so competent. Why is she still an acting Assistant Secretary of State? But regardless, now let us focus on what she was saying. She was saying that the debt burden is going to increase on Pakistan. This is a humongous question that has been raised. Pakistan immediately countered that argument by actually pointing out that only a very small percent, 30% of the total amount being spent is actually loans, and mostly the amount of interest that Pakistan is going to pay is somewhere around 2%, and that is not going to start in a few years. It is going to take its sweet time to actually materialize. What exactly is this? Is it some kind of counter pitch, some sales pitch? Because usually whenever I see a rebuttal or some kind of a comment about technology other than the US or investment other than the US, one has to actually think or ask oneself whether it is some kind of sales pitch. Don't buy the other technology, buy our stuff. She also talks about US model, which is investment and also, very interestingly, grants as well. But this is the problem when it comes to CPEC. Pakistan has given details as well. But there are three elements which are very important. One, of loyalty. The second, of credibility. And third, of reality. The loyalty factor is that when everything was down for Pakistan, Pakistan was facing a lot of trouble. That was the time when the Chinese actually came and invested in Pakistan. The second thing is credibility. Since Pakistan has already pledged to all these projects, it has to actually focus on credibility as well. The third thing is also important when you look at the reality. As I've pointed out, Pakistan has pointed out that there are many aspects to it, and Pakistan has actually gotten a better deal. We are going to talk about all these matters and more, and we have to try understanding two things. One, whether it is a sales pitch or it is just tutting, sitting on a distance. And the second aspect is whether the reality is as horrible as pointed out by the US Secretary, Assistant Secretary of State, or it is different. In order to help us understand these matters, we are joined by Lieutenant General retired named Khalid Lodhi Saab, former Defense Minister, National Security Advisor, and also, very importantly, former Defense Secretary as well. Thank you very much, sir, for being part of the program. Next to him is Riaz Bukhari Saab, former Ambassador, career diplomat, also a commentator on foreign policy. Thank you very much, sir, for being part of the program. Next to him is Shakil Rame Saab, a senior economist, also a policy pundit. Thank you very much, sir, for being part of the program. And we are going to benefit from your punditry as well a little bit later in the program.
It's only your generosity.
let me go to General Lodhi and ask him, sir, what exactly is it? Some kind of counter pitch?
You know, the first thing is that acting Assistant Secretary of State wants to say something, so she's not actually saying it from the point of view of economy, per se. It is international politics which is involved.
Right.
And I would say that if they have anything better to offer, so let them offer it.
Right.
And we will compare it.
Right.
And I am sure that it is a natural thing that whatever is better is normally adopted.
Do you think they are offering something?
I mean, if she's saying that we have better options, that is what she's saying.
Right.
Okay, I would say that we must look at it from two angles.
Right.
One is the history. the other is the attitude of the two great powers that we are dealing with. As far as history is concerned, I don't have to go into details, starting from, you know, the Karakoram Highway, and then our military relations and our political relations, our economic relations with China, they have been strong. And ups and downs were minor. More or less, they were regular in their nature. And as far as the US is concerned, we don't have to say. Whenever they require us, they embrace us and they love us. And whenever they don't require, they just throw us away and even say things quite close to abuses, I would say. So this is one aspect.
Only day before yesterday, there was a there is a congressional hearing going on impeachment. David Hale was actually telling that only two countries whose aid was blocked last year. The first was Pakistan.
So this is the history. Now the attitude. We know very well, it goes without saying, that America is fond of interfering in other countries' affairs, politically, economically, psychologically, media-wise, militarily, all, whatever they've been using it. And I don't have to give examples, there are numerous examples.
Is it really an either-or situation?
Not necessarily.
We can work with both?
Not necessarily. We can try to work with both. But here I see, I think Excellency will be able to put us wise on it. But I think we are reaching the limit of diplomacy. You know, diplomacy has its limits.
And this is quite interesting, because if you remember, Ambassador Saab, I've been actually asking, five foreign ministers of Pakistan have asked us that what if the new Cold War becomes too real, right? And the problem is that Pakistan has very close and cordial relations with both the countries. The one is our closest ally, the other is the longest serving ally, right? Right now, is it essential to actually go treat the situation as a zero-sum game?
I think the statement which you just mentioned, which was delivered at, you know, in Washington at a think tank on 21st, it is quite clear, a country-specific, unusually, I would say it's a warning. And as you have mentioned, if there was Cold War, friends, and I would go for a tested friend. China, since it's their independence, we have developed strategic relationship with them, which is not the case with the United States. The United States has signed a strategic relationship with India. So it's quite clear for us who is our friend and who is our tested friend.
We are also the non-NATO ally?
But non-NATO ally, what happened over there? Still we are, you know, as you mentioned in your intro, sanctions were imposed, aid was blocked for Pakistan last year. So if we are non-NATO ally, this should not have happened with us. So I am quite clear in that. But, you know, as far as the CPAC is concerned,
then we have to go with the trusted ally. But here's another question that I keep on asking. Remember, this was the question when we were, you know, faced by another paradox: Saudi Arabia versus Iran, and similar kind of situations elsewhere as well. No. Why do people ask us to choose? India has never asked to choose between countries.
We have to be very careful in that way, choosing or not choosing.
Why should not
be the situation. It should be very clear, clear for everybody on which side we will go.
India has very good relations with Iran. And it has very good relations with Saudi Arabia and Israel. India has very good relations with the US as well. It can work with China too.
That is, you know, the place where we have to see, can we follow the same? As far as China is concerned, a country which has been supporting us since 1949. The relationship
Actually,
has quite different.
We started supporting them first.
I mean, another way, obviously, we started, you know, that relationship. But during the military relationship, we have developed with them since long, and the intensive defense cooperation we are having with them.
So is it the ambassador, sir, is it the end of diplomacy now? Or our foreign office can double down and create
It's not end of diplomacy. It is never like that.
Right. Let me bring in Shakil Rame Saab. I said that we are going to benefit from your punditry. And here comes the actual question. Whatever was said by Alice Wells, especially about CPAC, because you focus on CPAC as well, tell us, do you see any reality in that?
Look, it was expected for a long time.
Okay.
Because
this statement.
This statement was expecting for a long time. Because if you observe the attitude, mm-hmm. of US, Western countries, and right. India. Mm-hmm. So they are opposing it. They were putting a narrative, always when they talk about the CPAC, they say it's a strategic project.
Okay. Who's opposing it? Because in the first BRI summit, actually America sent its envoy. India did not.
But at the lower level. Okay. They did not send their envoys.
Yeah,
at the
it was level. The first year of Donald Trump.
It was at the lower level. Even look at that, if you talk about the envoy, the latest China international import conference in China. Mm. So there are hundreds of their companies came to that conference, but US government did not come. Mm. So we have to look into that, how Pakistan handled it.
Yeah, but this question about debt payment, immediate debt payment, and the burden of debt and the burden of interest being put to debtree. How do you see those claims?
I'm coming to that. I'm just trying to build the scenario where these are statements okay. are coming. First, they were putting it as a strategic initiative. Okay. Pakistan and China said, no, it's an economic initiative. Okay. Because whenever you bring the strategic element, that means you are making it controversial.
Right.
For economic initiatives, it's a safe. Because you can talk about, we need to end the poverty, we need to talk about the employment, food security, so many things.
Right.
So there is no controversy. Mm-hmm. One thing. What happened? Pakistani, most of the people, they pick the strategic part mm-hmm. and try to discuss this element in our daily routine life.
Right.
So, second mistake. Whenever we talk about the CPAC, we say it's a China gift. It's a joint partnership. Because if you look at the initial document, when its volume was $45 billion, mm-hmm. $18.1 billion was committed from Pakistan.
Right.
So,
what
it's
is
a
the
partnership.
Total volume now?
It's a 62
right now.
Right now. But I don't know about what is the exact volume of Pakistani investment in
right.
it. But at that point, so we did not sell it like that, ki it's a joint initiative.
Right.
They were asking us, do this. Then they started to use different tools through the academia, through the think tanks, or through the other parts. Like, the first of all, they said, it's a debt trap. So it's not a debt trap. Why? Because its share of our total loan is only $5.8 billion.
Okay.
From if you talk about the $104 billion, including the liabilities.
Right.
So its share is very minimum. Hmm. Then it's only 2%.
And when are the payments?
It will be due after 2021. But okay. the fundamental difference from other Janaki loans, it is a productive loan. It's not about the consumptive loan. Most of our IMF loans or World Bank international loans, they were the consumptive loan.
Okay.
Productive loans are always better. Why? Because you produce something, you generate revenue.
And what is consumptive loan?
Consumptive loan, you just to take for example, we are taking for the last few years just to repayment of the debt.
Okay.
But during the last government, we took the loan just to support the dollar.
Right.
Artificially to manage the price of the
right.
Value of the dollar.
Okay.
So these are conservative because you are not producing anything.
Mm-hmm.
When you are not producing anything, you are vulnerable to take more loans to repay. So
okay.
we are that was the exact debt trap which they were we were
yeah,
in.
But US now talks about Hambantota and how
so,
that kind of.
So let us discuss one by one.
And then another argument, I have to actually bring it on table. They say that the development that is taking place is not going to create jobs because the Chinese companies actually bring their own labor.
I will come back to that. Second, their strategy. When they see like that, when they saw, look, debt trap is not working. They brought in FATF.
Okay.
So because when investment started to come to your country, they start to make it difficult for the investor to come. Because
okay.
when you are in FATF, no investor wants to delay in their payments mm-hmm. or go for the security, so many security checks.
Right.
Third, they're saying is you talk about the jobs. Mm-hmm. During the last 4 years, 127,000 jobs has been created. It's a data from the government of Pakistan. It's
right.
not like that from here
okay.
and there. 127,000 jobs mean 127,000 families.
127,000
so, jobs
in CPAC.
CPAC related projects.
Okay.
In first phase.
That
and
is
for the second phase, we are, what was the forecast? 1.2 million jobs.
Okay.
We could do 1.2 million jobs.
Right.
So it was a job of the government to make it public. So what we are producing?
The previous government could not do it, and this government is trying to actually.
It is on that website, Planning Commission website.
Yeah, but
and most of our academia, think tanks, our journalists, they are not doing that search work.
Right.
They are just trying to hear and say.
And that. This is an interesting point because General Saab, we have seen that how India is trying to play this possibility of a cold war between India, China, and the U.S. and it keeps on playing it right for past 20, 30 years. Now the situation is that somehow that propaganda is being inhaled by America. Is it not China's failure to actually project the concerns if the facts are that clear? Somebody should be telling it to the world.
Right. One thing is well known about China that Chinese other prowesses other than economy,
right,
they are not compatible. China is a rising power. It's a great power.
Right.
But you know, the great power status attained by America, which is a superpower, it is not only because of economy.
Right.
It is because of their media, it is because
soft
of
power.
Their political influence, it is because of their military power. And so they have a compatible mix of all these things. China is still developing, so they'll have to develop all these things.
And Pakistan, by the way, is genetically predisposed towards the West. We are talking in English, not in Cantonese or. Chinese.
That is the problem. There are two, one that our economic framework is attached very deeply towards West and US. And secondly, our elite is somehow or the other bent. They have a bent towards West and America. It is very difficult for them to really make this change of, having strong relations with the East.
Right.
That is the problem. I would like to bring in a point that, if America has any inhibitions,
right,
about this corridor being a strategic corridor and not an economic one, right, they should talk to us because we are the one through which the corridor is passing. And as an example, I can say that Chinese asked us, as they have done with the Iranians, that we can send some forces to protect this corridor, and we refused. We said we'll raise our own force and we are capable of protecting it. Whereas they are sending their forces to Iran. They accepted that protection part of it. Mm-hmm. So this indicates that we are also only interested in the economic side of it.
Right. But this new argument, General Saab, is not that it is a strategic, corridor. They say that economy is the strategy.
That is what they say.
And that becomes a problem.
That is what they say, and everything what is said is not meant.
Yeah.
Okay.
They are
actually scared that this corridor might not get change into a strategic corridor to be used by China, by Russia, by Central Asian countries, because they are all landlocked.
Right.
So this block, Russo-Chinese and Central Asian countries block, along with, if it also gets connected with Iran, because they have a shallower port and we have a deeper port. And that is why now Afghanistan comes in.
Right.
I've always been saying, and people have been laughing on me, that I said that America does not want peace in Afghanistan for the simple reason that it upsets the entire game.
Okay.
They don't want Russia, they don't want Central Asian countries, they don't want CPAC to flourish because that it will if there is a peace in America, in Afghanistan. So because it is coming from their foreign office, so it is an international relation thing.
It is coming from their foreign office, but remember when the same personality actually made a very pointed comment on India's treatment of Kashmir. At that time, in this program, or in this very space, I was told that it is her personal views. So there can be personal views
and
as well.
Because you mentioned Kashmir, you must be remembering that America had objected CPAC on this pretext also, that it is passing through a territory which is
right. India can do whatever it wants to and dispute it.
So their strategic partner is India.
Right.
They have to. They are in competition with China, with Russia, and some or the other, the CPAC doesn't fit into their design strategically and politically.
Forget about
economy.
General Saab, so this essentially, that this is a strategic partner, India and China, India and America are strategic partners. This is especially an Indian project, right? So I am not going to actually give up on that project and will keep on asking this question, Ambassador Saab. Why is it that we have convinced ourselves that everything is set in stone? I mean, in America, policies are made through lobbying. I mean, why is China? Pakistan doesn't have that kind of punching power, but China has a lot of punching power. Why is China not actually lobbying the West?
China should be using that option as well.
Is.
Because China has big resources,
yeah,
as well as, you know, large presence within the United States, much larger than us.
Right.
And they should be in a good position to use it as a company.
Pakistan who played the pivotal role in bringing China and the US together early, in the 70s, right?
70s, 60s.
Is it possible for Pakistan to actually convince both the countries that China keeps on talking about one country, two systems, right? Bring both investments and let us actually build trust between both of you?
Yeah, but you know, given the differences between China and the United States at the moment, particularly on the trade side,
right,
know, their bilateral trade.
But most of the U.S. deficit. Foreign debt is owned by China. China invests, its investment is the biggest in dollar.
But still, you know, the Chinese, trade surplus. Okay. It is worrying the United States,
right,
and they have done, I think, more than 50.
And India's is also worrying.
Donald Trump keeps on talking about that. And President Trump is worrying about, deficit in trade with India.
Every country.
With India and particularly China.
Right.
They are also criticizing China on Hong Kong, two systems, one country policy.
Right.
And I think in that scenario, perhaps it would be difficult for us to convince both sides
Not the job of the Foreign Office to work on the impossibilities to make them possible?
Yeah, but we have already a plate full of so many things, and to
so this is the end of diplomacy then?
No, not end of diplomacy. Maybe the time will come when we can look into those options as
so
well.
So it is the end of diplomacy, but not the end of hope.
Yeah, obviously not end of
hope. Without actually diplomacy is going to be miracles, right?
Yeah.
And that never happens actually.
Yeah.
Let me ask our economic pundit here. Sir, your take, is there a possibility that Pakistan can work with both the countries?
It is not possibility, it is definitely they will work with the both country.
Okay.
Because we are very well connected world, we are living in a very connected world.
Right.
No country can move so, without connection with everyone.
So you and don't buy this idea of a new Cold War?
So it is, it may be the new Cold War,
but it is very integrated world.
It doesn't mean you stop negotiating. It doesn't mean you stop diplomacy like that, Iran. So they are still negotiating on their nuclear deal with certain countries. So it doesn't mean that everything stop.
Yeah.
So it means you have to refine your tools again. What tools will work? One thing in diplomacy is very clear. Sometimes global scenario is very favorable for you. Sometimes global scenario is not favorable for you. Whatever you do, they don't buy it.
Mm-hmm.
So at this point of the time, we are facing with an empire which is falling empire. Mm-hmm. This, their attitude is entirely the similar attitude which British have in 1940s. When Americans were teaching them, don't behave like that, don't try to create hegemony or try to create your own influence, maintain your influence in your colonies. Mm-hmm. Let it open. Oh. So right now, America is falling now, falling empire. And Americans have to...
What convinces you? People keep on talking about America's empire ending. I mean, Pax Americana never ends.
No.
Let me complete
my argument, then you can find it. So, how America built its empire?
Right.
By creating alliances and the partnerships.
Right.
So, how America can think... By leaving these partnerships and alliances, they can remain an empire.
Yeah.
No, it is not possible.
No, but
one
America,
thing and second thing.
America might create.
I just quote you one very important
Shakil sir, with due respect, since you are talking about their alliances, America might be building their empire through their alliances. But America was the last to enter the First World War and the Second World War. This is what happens.
So let me come to that point. I am just coming bit by bit there. If you have watched a few days ago, a very short documentary conducted by Economist, The Economist, that is a famous magazine.
Yeah, there are surveys, right?
They said, why America is against Huawei? 5G technology. So this, at the end, they proved there is nothing related to security. Their security threats are very minimum. So what at the end they concluded, the statement by Trump, he said, we will not allow any country to outperform US technological companies for the future.
Yeah,
so they are, so if you look at that, China is moving very quickly and very fast on the technology.
I'm really glad that you actually pulled out of many examples, you pulled out Huawei's example. Yeah. Why? Because within 5 minutes, it was shown that their technological progress might be big, but the fact is that all the essential patents lie with the US. So without those patents, Huawei is nothing.
No. That is, look, that is a myth which we are still discussing.
I have to go back to General Saab.
If you're talking about Android, they have created Harmony. In artificial intelligence,
I'm not talking about Android. I'm talking about their chipset.
They are seeing in next few.
Kirin's chipset is actually an update of their other two US, Intel and AMD.
Let me complete.
Yeah.
Second thing, artificial intelligence. Third thing, quantum computing. China is way ahead than the other companies in the US.
Google has actually crossed the threshold.
Quantum computer, they have the advantage.
What is the difference?
In the market economy, you put everything before that, oh, we are doing this, we have achieved this. In the Chinese model, they keep silent until unless their time has come to respond. They kept silent on the Harmony program until unless Google threatened them, we will not allow you to use it.
Most of the apps that are used on Harmony are going to be used on Harmony are US based. So if you divorce them from your own service, that is your choice. The point that I was trying to make, General Saab, is that there seems to be this projection of a boogeyman. In truth, China might be able to work with the US, right? And they are going to work with the US. At this moment, it seems that a lot of propaganda is filtering into the US system and the Western system. Somehow, Pakistan should be able to actually cover its own bases.
Right. I think, as you mentioned earlier, that we should not take it as a zero-sum game, and it is possible, as Excellency was saying, and as he's also saying. But, once it comes to the prowess of America, America is not alone. It has got an aura around it, an aura of democracy, aura of capitalism, aura of way of life.
Right.
So these three things have actually, they are quite expansive in nature once you look at the world. So whereas they are shrinking, all right, but in my own assessment, I don't know, it is going to take some time before America stops rising and starts flattening.
Right.
And after that, it will come, start going down. So far, it's not going down.
So this argument has made, and both of you actually made it, that somehow Americans have convinced themselves and Indians have convinced themselves that they belong together.
Right.
Why do we think that they have convinced themselves?
No.
What is the common denominator?
The common denominator is
democracy.
In fact, there are two different interests which have combined in a way. India has very strong interest in this region vis-a-vis Kashmir, Afghanistan, and even China. And America has interest vis-a-vis Russia, China, and other countries. So there's a combination for different reasons.
Right.
India wants to subdue Pakistan. India wants to also contain China to an extent, and America definitely wants to contain China and all that. But
America doesn't want to contain India.
Right. They would like to.
Modi's India.
They would like.
This is what I was saying, that if the common denominator is democracy, it is gone.
Any great power would like the minimum of greater powers rising. Right. They would like to be alone. What America is trying to extend their status of unipolarity, which of course is being diluted. So that would be their desire. But as he was saying, and he was right, that Americans' greatness was also due to the political blocks and economic blocks and military blocks.
Right.
Whereas China is only interested into economic blocks. Mm-hmm. Okay, they are neither making political blocks nor making military blocks,
right,
except for Russia, a little understanding which they have. So in my opinion, and of course, we cannot teach China. China is a great country. One day, they will realize that they will have to go for other coalitions also. Okay. And economic coalitions alone will not take them very far.
Right.
Because that is sticking a thin neck very right. far right. without the protection of the political clout and the military clout.
But is it not also very disarming? I mean, when you are actually focusing on economics, I mean, other person is going to actually make a fool of himself criticizing it.
Right, right, that is true.
I mean, if you are going for strategic predominance, okay. then it becomes
But
a
one
problem.
Thing, another thing I think we are all aware of, that yeah. China has been advising us, mm-hmm. and Excellency will be able to tell us better, that China has been advising us to keep good relations with America.
Right.
I mean, it is in their interest also to
Absolutely.
Keep...
Absolutely. And this is what I'm saying. They might have a direct connection, but Pakistan's role cannot be underestimated. Pakistan brought them together.
Right.
It can bring them together again.
The only thing is that I just pray and I hope that we remain so clever and we are so clever, because if we were so good, we would have done so many things within our country.
Yeah.
We have not been able to govern it properly. We have not been able to put our economy
yeah, but
right.
We, General Saab, it might be true.
So forgive me.
General Saab, I understand your skepticism. Right. But with your respect, you haven't seen another phoenix of a country oh. that repeatedly rises from ashes. I mean, this is Pakistan
okay.
that keeps on pulling itself together. And
that
someday,
is true. That is true.
Yeah. So, and it is thanks to people like you, actually. Ambassador Saab, earlier, regarding technology, I was being told that AI, China has the lead. Actually, when you look at the AI pundits, they say that data collection method has a tie between China and America. Half of them, the Chinese technologies, actually have access to greater data because their political model. And America, since it has more access to business and more private issues, they have different kind of data. These seem to be broken part of the same picture. So you honestly think that now they're not going to work together at all?
I think no doubt China is growing at a very, you know, high, I would say, speed in technology as well. But still, China has not attained a level where it can compete the Western technology as such. So it will remain, you know, I would say, number two.
Okay.
I don't think China can really challenge.
But, the problem is, and I'm not arguing that India should be somehow an enemy. How can you lock out a billion people of the system, right? The point is that there are many problems that are rising their head. One is environment itself, climate, right?
Yeah.
The second is poverty, it still continues. Then there are diseases. And finally, since he was talking about AI is also displacing, automation is also displacing a lot of jobs. So every one has to actually look at those challenges and work together. Why do we have to pick and choose?
You know, whenever we get any new technology,
right?
Obviously we will lose certain jobs.
No, but this time is different. The machine that is going to be emulated can do all the jobs that you can do and more.
More, but at the cost of losing some jobs or, you know.
All jobs.
Some, I would not say all.
All.
Maybe, you know, in future all.
10 years.
Nature of jobs will change.
Yeah.
And you have to actually suggest which jobs. Because I keep on looking for an answer, I can't find any.
Yeah.
They are going to have the same neural model as our brains function, only that they keep on adding to the weight. My point was not this. My point was that there are multiple threats that face all the countries.
Yeah.
So why actually live in the 19th or 20th century and think that it is a Cold War? We have to come out of the straitjacket of Cold War, right? Right?
Sure. No, Cold War mindset has to be, you know, I would say, changed.
Okay.
For the better one, and the best option, obviously, which you were talking earlier, is the diplomatic, you know, option to talk to each other.
Yeah.
And
actually, diplomatic is also political. Why not actually work together on economics?
Economics is the basic, you know, thing, obviously.
So join China rather than containing it.
Obviously, you know, working on economic side for joint ventures, joint cooperation, that is the key to resolve our problems, poverty alleviation, you are talking environmental issues and other related things.
Right. Shakil Ramesh Saab, since we are talking about West versus China, US versus China, one thing, since you actually quote a lot of numbers as well, the number of people who speak English in this country and the number of people who speak Chinese. No. If we have taken a strategic turn already, or we have decided if there is going to be a fight between mom and pop, we are going to go with whom? So we have to actually acclimatize with their culture as well, are we?
Look, English is not the global language. Even Chinese are investing a lot to learn it. Look at, there are millions, hundreds of million kids there is being studied in the English schools. Because look, if we want to understand China, we need to first study their different thoughts, how they're moving. First, they are not dreaming to become the hegemon power. They are looking toward the regional security matters. Mm-hmm. If you look at their new doctrine of defense, mm-hmm. they are talking about the new regions. How we can, they don't want to be the world policeman. Mm-hmm. Second thing, they believe in a partnership, not alliances. Alliances or blocs are always against somebody. Partnerships are just a partnership. They work together to move it somewhere.
All right.
So for to share the prosperity. Shanghai Cooperation Organization is one organization. Mm-hmm. Then they are also introducing new financial instruments like Asian Infrastructure Investment Bank.
Right.
So they are bringing in. So they believe in partnership, not the alliances.
One is Asian Infrastructure Bank. The other is also BRICS Bank.
BRICS
also actually brought.
So that
China is also there. India is also there.
Third thing, so they always say, let's work together. Mm-hmm. They don't say we want to come.
So why is it that we are talking right now? You're talking about a world which is four-dimensional. Why is it that the narrative in the US, especially when you talk about the State Department, it seems to be a two-dimensional flat discussion? I mean, it is either or situation.
So that's maybe the reading of some people. But at the end, I'm looking at that. So there will
by
be dialogue.
By some people, you mean Ellis Wells. So,
look, they are playing smart. They are just they're just trying to measure the depth of the water. So okay. How long we can go? It's a negotiation table. It's not just when you go to negotiation table.
Well, how do you measure the depth of water? By bringing some kind of scale, right?
So by bringing
not
reaction
standing
in
on
that,
the shore and shouting at the water.
It's like that. They are just they must be analyzing the response by Pakistan and China.
Okay.
How much response they have? One thing, second, when you come to the negotiation table, first of all, your negotiations are your positions are very far away. So we will not move an inch from there.
No, but
later you negotiate.
No, hang on.
When
Ellis Wells is talking about investment model coupled by grants, US grants, right? Then you have to look at the possibility of US businesses coming to Pakistan. I mean, you keep on citing Pepsi Cola and Coca Cola, right? That is not going to cut it. You have to bring some new investors. Where are they?
So that's what I'm saying. If you allow me only 2 minutes, I will explain.
You have the entire program.
No, only 2 minutes.
But yeah,
without interruption, I will explain you. Yeah. First of all, so they're trying to measure it. Pakistan and China, they are both open for any type of investment in CPEC. So they are saying, let's come and invest it.
Then why are they not telling it to the US?
We're telling them. So not only US, we're telling to the whole world. So anybody can invest. Why German companies are coming in? Why French companies are coming here? Why the Saudi companies are coming here? Why the US, their companies are coming to Pakistan?
Which companies?
So Microsoft has showed the interest. They want to invest in Pakistan. Okay. So there are other global with their players. They want to invest in Pakistan.
I'm very grateful for his interest in Pakistan as well. But whenever I listen to the name of Bill Gates, it is usually about vaccines.
Not only vaccines, but the letter delivered to Prime Minister, it was about the investment. Okay. The second thing, why Americans
letter
are very
intent?
Why they are Americans, not intent, they show his will, so he wanted to invest in Pakistan. There are other American company, Coca-Cola has announced they want to enhance its investment in Pakistan. So they are not creating jobs. Mm-hmm. And their economy is not creating new jobs because their private sector has gone outside of country and they are not paying taxes.
Okay.
So that is their real problem. Just to they don't have the money to spend there, so are creating new jobs. So they are trying to blame somebody else. No, who is, it's like that, if you are short
under fast, Donald Trump, let us face it, okay. He has brought a lot of jobs back to his country.
No, that are not sustainable.
On economic term, sure that Amazon is not being
that
taxed.
Is a mistake. On economic term, that is not sustainable because the loans which has been extended to the company,
General, they were not
according to the merit.
You know, General Saab wants to add.
Whenever we talk of geo-economy and geopolitics and geo-strategy, normally it is very fashionable to say nowadays that geo-economy nowadays is leading. It was always leading, geo-economy. But this urge to control resources, it creates warlike situations.
Right.
And human race, in my opinion, has not yet developed to an extent where you can banish wars. Very good, intents of China agreed, but you may not be interested in war. War may be interested in you. So I don't think this Chinese thing. I'm saying it for the third time.
Are you referring to the Hitler next door?
Or whatever it is.
Modi.
I mean, if we look at the number of conflicts, number of physical conflicts, number of wars which are taking place today on the globe, with such advanced civilized world. This thing comes to your mind that you cannot live without war.
But one thing I was saying, the Americans don't have the edge which the Americans have in the Second World, up to the Second World War.
I mean,
they don't have the edge.
I mean, it
will not go for that. Don't
worry. That a journalist is saying that you cannot work without war, and an economist is saying
I'm not
saying that.
The history. Right. I'm saying that even today, right? You can ask him. But so far, the historical evidence is
right.
And empirical evidence says that you cannot prevent wars, and it will be because of economic reasons.
Right. And it is true that nobody says that wars are going to end. But the point was that there was hope that as we get civilized more and more around the world, the wars are going to be shrinking to lesser developed or lesser civilized countries. But we are talking about two most civilized countries, I mean America. Who is more civilized than American?
You think so?
Yeah, I believe that.
And who's the most warlike country in the world?
Yeah, America again. Right. But the China also is very civilized. I mean, their point of view, their wisdom is 5,000 year old. Why is it that they can't see a basic fact that my children might be able to do, that you have to work together?
I think the world is becoming civilized day by day. Yeah. People are no more talking wars as a fashion which they used to talk, 10 years ago or 20 years ago, because, the weapons which, major powers are having, and obviously if you are having weapons and there is war, you tend to use them to advance your interests, and the enormous losses. So I don't think we should talk war in that sense.
Yeah.
The only answer is to cooperate with each other, talk to each other.
Yeah.
That is the only best way possible.
Find more common ground.
Common ground, obviously.
And when it comes to defense industry, that can be requested to explore the universe.
Well, defense industry and economic growth.
Transfer the focus into space.
Colonize
space.
Do you think what is becoming civilized?
Why not?
Due to their strategic vision? No. They are becoming civilized because out of no choice. Because this time, it would be mutually assured destruction.
Right.
The level of weapon every country have.
And now the situation has moved a bit away from MAD or mutual assured destruction. Now it is going to be machine assured destruction. Your weapons are going to decide whether they are going to destroy you or not.
So world is not becoming civilized due to their strategic vision. They are becoming civilized due to out of no
perhaps
choice.
Perhaps as a country that has suffered a lot because of war, that it had to fight on its own ground, maybe we can tell the world that instead of fighting war, let us work together. Agreed, sir?
Yeah. Right.
Agreed, sir? We have been
out. No choice.
Agreed, sir?
No choice.
Thank you very much. On that very positive note, we have to conclude the program. General Saab, thank you very much for your time. Ambassador Saab, thank you very much for your time as well. Shakil Ramesh Saab, thank you very much for your time as well. Viewers, you have listened to our discussion. Of course, when you talk about a relationship between the two countries, there's always, or between any two individuals, you can always look at things that divide you and things that unite you. If you look at the positive side, then it becomes a positive sum game. And that is the biggest problem. The countries that keeps pushing this narrative around the world that there is going to be another Cold War and it is going to be the sole beneficiary is India. And frankly, when you look at the health of Indian polity, you don't see a very healthy country. So one has to ask again, if you're going to contain China and work with India, because India is your natural ally because it is a democracy, where is democracy now? Where are the democratic values? All institutions have been brushed aside. Now it is a more Hitler-esque country. So one has to keep asking these questions, and let us hope that the two countries that are very dear to Pakistan, one is US, the other is China, can find a way to work together and invest also in Pakistan. This was today's program. Thank you very much for watching. Take care.